My name is Sofia Lukso. This is the second part of the lecture on smart grids. Today, I would like to discuss with you the so-called demand-side management. Demand-side management means adapting the electricity demand to the electricity production through various methods such as financial incentives and education. In the future, energy systems, more and more wind and solar generation will be expected. However, making a perfect weather forecast may be difficult, even impossible, and consequently, the prediction of wind and solar production will be uncertain. Besides this uncertainty, we also need to cope with the variability in the system's generation output. The wind and solar radiation intensity is not every day the same. Both together, variability as well as uncertainty drive a need for greater flexibility in the power sector. This flexibility can come either from flexible generation technologies with efficient ramping or from flexible demand, storage, and/or interconnections. In this lecture, we will discuss the flexibility needs forthcoming from variable generation and we'll describe general approaches to address the flexibility from the demand side. Moreover, negative electricity prices are likely to emerge where the power system as a whole is not flexible enough. Hence, it is hard and costly to adapt to changing conditions on the demand and on the supply side. A negative price indicates that power generation companies are willing to pay the consumer when they buy energy. This is mostly due to a combination of high production from renewable energy sources, which are generally characterized by a very low or zero marginal generation costs and low demand. Negative prices generally occur on very sunny and windy non-working days with low demand. Their way firstly introduced on the German market, followed by France and Austria. It should be stressed that negative prices create an economic incentive for consumers to shift their consumption patterns to capture the opportunity of being paid. At the same time, the emergence of negative prices shows that the generating fleet has too little flexibility and/or that grid interconnections are insufficient within a market area. There are many types of demand-side management. Manipulations of load shape can be done, for example, by delaying a peak or spreading it. Also, electric mobility has the potential to play an important role in the future power systems by adjusting demand of the electric vehicles to the variable generation. But how can that be done, taking into account the different interests of the relevant actors? Electric mobility is in principle greener, and depending on the source of the electricity production, electric vehicles can produce less CO2 and improve air quality. An electric vehicle uses a relatively large amount of electricity. For comparison, an average household in the Netherlands uses an average about 10 kilowatt hour per day. An electric vehicle, based on the current average travel distance per day, uses about 6 kilowatt hour per day. In addition, it is expected that, when left to the consumer convenience, this increased demand will occur mostly during existing peak demand hours, when the car owner will arrive home mostly around 6 p.m. Therefore, if not controlled, electric mobility will increase electricity peak load and will thereby impact the electricity grid. Intelligent charging, called controlled charging, can avoid an extensive increase of the peak load by spreading it. However, controlled charging does not mean the same for car owners or aggregators representing them, for distribution network operators, and for energy producers. all of them think differently about intelligent charging. Car owners will prefer charging during the periods with lowest electricity prices, mostly at night, while electricity network operators will prefer charging without violating network capacity and minimizing reinforcements of the grid. As already said, the impact of electric mobility on the grid and the electricity demand will heavily depend upon the time and the duration at which consumers charge their vehicles. To sum up, the impact depends on several factors, namely grid characteristics, developments in the existing energy systems, type of charging station, and charging behavior of vehicle users. All these aspects can make it difficult for network operators to anticipate to electric mobility, but they need to do this by identifying critical grid components and deciding an appropriate location for charging stations. The demand response potential of electric vehicles is large due to the flexibility in the charging process by shifting it in time. Many other types of loads have this ability too. As an example of another type of responsive demand, a cold storage warehouse can be given. A cold storage warehouse is basically a huge refrigerator where goods are stored at very low temperature. Suppose, for this illustrative example, that the cold store has PV production on the same site and it can withdraw power from the grid and feed it back. In many countries, and presumably even more so in the future, tariffs for consuming are higher than for delivering energy to the grid. The challenge is to find the optimal cooling schedule that minimizes the total cost of cooling by maximizing the profit of sold PV energy minus the cost of electricity withdrawn from the grid, while maintaining the cold storage temperature within the limits. There is a clear similarity between EV load management and demand response of cold store. An approximation of temperature dynamics of the cold store is similar to the description of energy content of an EV battery in a car. Instead of electrochemical energy stored in a battery, we have here heat, actually cold, stored in the cold store warehouse. It is interesting to investigate the influence of different electricity tariff structures on the optimal cooling schedule and to optimize this. The cooling trajectories can be understood in terms of the trade-offs. In this case, trade-offs between thermal leakage to the environment, time-dependent PV revenues, and prices for consuming electricity. Our investigation showed that the various tariff structures, as indicated on the slide, lead to markedly different optimal cooling trajectories. In one of our investigations, we took as starting point the solar PV generation installed on the national level amounts to approximately 50% of the peak load. We found that, maybe not surprisingly, the energy management was optimal in case E, where electricity prices were low during PV generation. It's thus clearly the highest in case prices are defined on the spot market with high PV generations. Check our readings for all detailed calculations. Therefore, it should be clear that the potential value of look-ahead energy management strongly depends on the tariff structure. In particular, when there is a high penetration of renewable energy sources without a fixed feed-in tariff, there seems to be a large value for demand response. But how to define this right tariff structure to enlarge the value of the demand response? that is not the task of the owner of the cold storage warehouse, but of policymakers and regulators. They have to formulate new demand-side policies and to define well-functioning market for the demand-side management. In the future energy systems, with high levels of wind and solar energy, market and policy changes are required. To conclude, demand-side management is going to be increasingly important for the future power systems. By developing controlled demand systems, for example, using electric mobility and cold store, the capacity problems around peak demand hours can be challenged, and efficient integration of renewable energy sources in the power system can be realized. This path forward will lead to an increasingly reliable, sustainable, flexible, and affordable power system. Thank you very much for listening.